When he was first born, I always say he even cried in music. Sounded like a song rather than a cry. Byron did everything to a tune, whether it was answering me, yes, mother, coming, mother. Everything was music. Everybody had to put up with that because that was the way Byron was.
Byron was very mischievous and seemed to recall mom fussing at him a lot. He always seemed like he got into some trouble. He provided a lot of laughter in our home. Byron would, you know, out of the blue, just lay hands on people, you know, slap their forehead, say, come out, you know, try to. Having come into Henry Ford High School, he, for a while, lived in the shadow of Ivan, which may have made it, you know, difficult for him to really carve his own space. He was known as Ivan's brother.
When he got to high school, of course, he went to every musical that he could go to.
He was the star of Oklahoma, he was in The Wiz, he was the Scarecrow.
I mean, he was really into it.
You know, he couldn't walk past a piano without sitting down and playing a couple of chords and singing.
When I really figured out, oh, people actually like my brother, is when he sang It's Impossible by Peeble Bryson in the talent show at high school, and the girls were going crazy, screaming and going crazy, and it was just like, oh, I guess my brother is pretty talented.
He was an incredible singer back in high school.
As we were growing up, you know, together through elementary school, junior high, high school, I have to say this, and I'm just going to be just transparent right now. I was always very, very jealous.
He always seemed like he had a mission, and he was pursuing that mission.
Byron went to a music center. It's called Interlochen.
And it was an amazing thing because a young black boy, you didn't see that much at Interlochen, but they really connected with him.
Well, he went to Oakland University, first of all, and he wanted to major in the same thing his brother was majoring in, which was communication.
My mother always knew and pushed him that his heart was in music.
And I kept saying to Byron, music is so your thing, maybe you should do that.
He was one of the gentlemen that I sort of noticed on campus, mainly because he was a Kappa. Being a Kappa back in the undergrad days was a lot of fun. We were sort of the big men on campus. We let us tell it, we threw the best parties, had all the prettiest girls at our parties, and put on the best step shows. The fundamental purpose of Kappa Alpha Psi is achievement. And so we all strive towards that ideal. But Byron always just had a positive spirit, you know, full of energy, great sense of humor. Downright silly at times. And Byron would be the one guy who'd come in with the silliest joke or interrupt our studying for the fraternity stuff to make us sing some song. He really lightened the mood when we really needed that mood lightened.
Many people don't know is Byron Cage actually wrote my letter of recommendation for me to become a member of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated.
Byron was one of the guys who helped make the chapter work. He was one of the guys who put in the work when nobody was around to pat you on the back, or there were no girls to see you in there working and putting forth that effort. So we definitely missed that when Byron left.
Byron transferred to Morehouse as a later student.
I believe it was his sophomore year. He was called by Morehouse to come in, participate and receive scholarship in their Morehouse Men's Glee Club.
He was a classic gentleman because he didn't come like the rest of us green in puberty. He had come already gone through his bro mitzvah.
It was during that time that he transitioned to Morehouse that, you know, you really saw just Byron as an artist just blossom even more because he was around music 24/7. He was challenged in college and vocally challenged. One of his biggest idols of all time was Thomas Whitfield. There was a youth choir at Greater Grace. I remember just them really pulling up Byron and saying, you've got more to give here. And because of that, they put him out and allowed him to start directing the youth choir.
We go into New Birth and Byron's got a Bobby Brown Gumby haircut swooped to the side, a tuxedo shirt on, and dress pants hanging out. I said, man, what kind of church is this?
I remember one time, we was in rehearsal, and and Byron, you know, was trying to direct the choir, and there was a guy sitting in the back. He was like this, like, you ain't gonna tell me what to do.
He grabs that mic and he says what he needs to say.
He's not fearful of anything, and he always desires to give God his very best.
Change our whole understanding and appreciation of worship at the church.
It's gonna push that envelope until UPS can't deliver it.
And he takes the church and the body of Christ to a level of worship that is powerful and anointed.
His song selections are just that.
He sings the way he needs to sing, and he's always effective.
When he ministers, sometimes it feels like the church building is too small for the anointing.
It's a full production. When Byron is doing it, you feel like you're on Broadway under a steeple.
It's almost as if he's in a place that seats 100,000, and in reality he's in a place that seats 3,000, and the church just can't contain it.
And an experience that you don't normally get in the music ministry.
The way he gives God the glory, it's just amazing to watch.
He really is a church worshiper.
And that's why he is the Prince of Praise and Worship.
Something that some people don't really know about Byron is how obsessive Byron was with Jennifer Holliday. Is how enamored with very endowed, loud, gospel sort of singing women.
You know, people think, oh, Byron is only new gospel people because he grew up in gospel, but he really loved Peabo Bryson and his style of singing.
I hear through the grapevine that Byron Cage has been signed to Air Records. He came out with a group called Purpose, and he has some of the greatest female singers behind him. In 95, Dwell Among Us. Let your presence dwell among us. Then he came out with his second project in 1990, Six Transparent in His Presence. Those beginnings are oftentimes with a lot of frustration and pressure. At his records, we're not getting the greatest play.
Challenges that he faces in the industry as an artist.
People don't know the sacrifice that he made, the anguish that he had to go through, the rejections that he went through.
So the struggles to getting there was not actually the doors just opened up for him.
Knocking on the door. No, we don't know. He waited, and from the time that they told him yes, there was another 2 years he had to wait before that recording actually happened.
Sometimes, you know, you have to go through some of the various avenues that were positioned for gospel music or for gospel singers.
He always is one to persevere.
He had to scratch. He had to work.
But he kept going forward.
But we saw him. We saw him coming.
We were riding in the car one day, he would let me listen to the songs and say, which song do you think is gonna be good? And it was the first CD that was the breakout CD.
When he came forth with this particular project, this was the turning point of Byron Cage.
The Lord is here.
Come on, sing it.
The presence of the Lord is here.
Come on, I feel it in.
I feel it in the atmosphere.
Oh.
And they started playing it locally. And it was a big thing, man. We both cried and just couldn't believe that it was happening.
Classic, iconoclastic songs, I think, is the very first gospel song I ever downloaded on iTunes.
And it took everybody, the whole world, by surprise.
I mean, that's Michael Jackson's Thriller. That's Rick James' Cold-Blooded.
He was introducing us to another sound.
The production, the music, the worship on there. And
it went from the sanctuary to the club in 3 minutes.
He was not doing that thinking that he was going to sell millions of records. He just wanted to record a CD. And he was faithful in what he did, and God bless the man, you know.
When he called us to tell us he was nominated, we were just like, oh my gosh!
And the Stellar Award goes to Brian.
I remember when they announced his name, I mean, we just went bananas. Being honored by your peers and people in the industry, it's amazing.
Seeing those things come to fruition is very inspiring in and of itself.
Byron is the biggest giver that I know.
He met Isaiah Thomas and Elements of Praise and watched them do their hit at the time was I Will Bless the Lord. Byron loved that song so much. A lot of times artists will see songs and almost get jealous by it, you know what I mean? Or, you know, just kind of brush it aside. But he celebrated Isaiah, and not only celebrated it, but asked Isaiah to record that song. It became the song of the year the next year. He's the guy that will, you know, help and support and develop artists to be who they should be in Christ.
This brother loves people and uses any and everything that he has to help others.
About 7 years ago, I just fell off the wagon big time, and I was a leper. Nobody was to touch me, nobody was to be around me. They would pray from a distance. And I had found myself in a bad place, man. And he did what Isaiah 61 says. You know, when I was hungry, he fed me. When I was naked, he clothed me. When I didn't have a place to lay my head, man, he, you know, had me in the penthouse looking over the whole city. And I know that was a difficult time for him because I had you know, had a tremendous fall from grace. And that was just a bad time. It's a bad time.
Regardless of what people do, regardless of what people say, he's still Byron and he's consistent. What you see is what you get.
Byron Cage is a living legend. For me, by not just changing the sound of gospel music, but changing the wardrobe of gospel music.
He can do any format that he desires to do.
He is unique in the sense that he not only sings gospel music, but he is a musician.
Byron, to me, is one of the best vocalists, not only in the gospel music industry, but period.
His voice could go so high. And he could sing so high in the alto soprano range, but he was a first tenor.
Byron Cage set the runway for there to be a Kirk Franklin, for there to be a Ty Tribbett, for there to be a Jay Moss.
There is not a city or state in America, if you know gospel, that does not know the name Byron Cage.
If I could sum up Byron in one word.
He was a prankster.
Edgy.
It's laughter.
Incredible.
Royal.
Light skin with curly hair.
A worshiper.
Loyalty.
Anointed.
Downright silly at times.
Is a rebel.
Mama's boy.
That once he accomplishes something that he feels like he has to keep going.
I really see him doing more and more TV.
I think Chris Rock, Jamie Foxx, Eddie Murphy, they could take a page from this guy because he really is a funny guy.
Yes, Byron can sing, Byron can direct, Byron can write.
When it comes down to it, Byron was never the singer in the family. He was the dancer.
Byron can dance his behind off.
When Michael Jackson came onto the scene, could have blown Michael Jackson like totally off the face of the earth.
Byron don't move his legs too much. He all shoulders. He all shoulders and upper body. He has to be on camera. This thing right here belongs to Byron Cage.
He's a looker, so he won't be bad on the eye, of course.
Somebody needs to follow you on a daily basis, and if they did follow you on a daily basis in the future and came up with sort of a reality concept, that's kind of like what I see is kind of one of the next things you want to do.
What a lot of people don't know is you are not a performer. You are not an entertainer. You are God's man. The reason why we recognize you as God's man is because you have demonstrated in all of your years of ministry character, integrity, and nobility. We are proud that you are a dear brother of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated, but more than that, we are proud that you have represented the kingdom of God with honor, with character, and with integrity. Great and mighty is our